Okay, the final item of business this evening is the members' business debate on motion 2886 in the name of Emma Harper on Eating Disorder Awareness Week 2022. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Emma Harper to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to lead this evening's debate on Eating Disorders Awareness Week 2022, which takes place from the 28th of February to the 6th of March. And I want to thank colleagues across Chamber who have supported my motion allowing this debate to go ahead today. And for many years, this debate was proposed by former MSP Dennis Robertson, who lost his daughter Caroline to anorexia nervosa in 2011. This is what Dennis said in his members' debate in February 2012. Dennis said, "I want people to be aware of the symptoms and get help as soon as they can. I'm trying to ensure that GPs and other medics become more aware of the dangers." I agree with Dennis, and I know the Scottish Government has taken action, and I will expand on that in a wee bit. Dennis now chairs the Scottish Government's Lived Experience Panel on Eating Disorders, and he has undoubtedly played a part in putting this subject on the political agenda. Presiding Officer, I also want to thank the Eating Disorders charity BEAT for the excellent work they continue to do to support those at risk of and those who are living with an eating disorder. This includes supporting families and friends, of course. Presiding Officer, it's great to have folk in the gallery again, a sign that we are emerging from the... It's a sign that we're emerging from the pandemic, and I welcome the staff and the ambassadors from BEAT. I invite members to join us for a photograph at the bottom of the stairs to the public gallery after the debate. Everybody's welcome. Presiding Officer, around 1.25 million people across the UK and 1 in 50 people here in Scotland currently live with an eating disorder, and the numbers have increased during the COVID-19 pandemic. The pandemic has exacerbated this with a reported increase of 86% in referrals to specialists between 2019 and 2020. Types of eating disorders include binge eating disorder, bulimia, anorexia, other specified feeding or eating disorder, which is OSFED, and avoidant restrictive food intake disorder, ARFID. A very dangerous eating disorder is diabulimia. This occurs when people with type 1 diabetes deliberately omit their insulin to control their weight. It is extremely dangerous to omit your insulin. Eating disorders have high mortality rates, with anorexia having the highest mortality rate of any mental illness, and 1 in 6 people with binge eating disorder are trying to end their life. People with eating disorders typically develop severe physical health problems, and overall quality of life has been estimated to be as low as in symptomatic coronary heart disease or severe depression. Without early intervention, many people become unable to participate in education or employment, but recovery is possible. Access to the right treatment and support is life-changing, and early intervention provides the best chance of recovery. The key symptoms of eating disorders include excessively worrying about weight or body shape, avoiding social situations where food may be involved, frequently visiting the toilet after meals for prolonged periods, and not being upfront about the food a person may be consuming. It is important for family members, friends and colleagues to be aware of these signs. There is some speculation around the causes of an eating disorder. However, research has shown that there is a link between eating disorders and depression, low confidence and low self-esteem. Presiding Officers, one of the key asks of BEAT is to ensure that healthcare practitioners are fully aware of eating disorders and to improve eating disorder education across Scotland. I welcome that BEAT have had positive engagement with almost all medical schools in Scotland, including Dundee, Glasgow, Aberdeen, and BEAT continue to engage with the others. I urge all medical schools to work with BEAT so that our next generation of doctors and healthcare professionals are able to identify eating disorders at an early stage and properly direct people to specialist services. Another of the key asks from BEAT is social media, which we know can be a factor contributing to eating disorders. We need to ensure people are using social media safely, and there are great tips on BEAT's website. Presiding Officer, in March 2021, the Scottish Government completed a National Eating Disorder Service Review. The National Eating Disorder Service Review includes a total of 15 ambitious recommendations focused on ensuring all those affected by eating disorders receive timely and appropriate care and support. These recommendations include better coordination of national activity and data collection, the national availability of self-help resources, which should be available to everyone at any stage of life in Scotland, and a focus on early diagnosis with the aim of prevention. It is welcome that an implementation group has been set up to review timescales and cost of implementation of the recommendations, and that these three subgroups have been created within the implementation group: a training group, a standards group and a data group. The data group has not met yet, though. I would therefore be grateful if the Minister could outline when the implementation group is likely to report and when the lived experience panel, chaired by Dennis Robertson, will meet. Presiding Officer, this week I contacted the dietetic team in NHS Dumfries and Galloway. The team has a dietitian specifically working with those living with and at risk of developing eating disorders. I heard that because of the rurality of Dumfries and Galloway, some people who are at risk of developing an eating disorder may not be picked up as easily or may be reluctant to access support because of the travel involved in attending appointments. While this situation has improved through the move to virtual appointments, there still exists an issue for people rurally in accessing eating disorder support services, but especially face-to-face, because that is part of the specialty need, is to see people face-to-face. So again, I would ask the Minister, to ensure that rural areas are included in the approach moving forward. In addition, I also welcome the Scottish Government's commitment of £120 million for a Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund, with a focus on improving support for mental health in primary care settings and enhanced community support. And I welcome the Scottish Government's increased investment in BEAT. Presiding Officer, I want to briefly mention that this Saturday I will be delivering the keynote address at PosiFest here in Edinburgh. PosiFest is a positive psychology festival which aims to support positive health and well-being through providing a safe space to explore issues around mental health. There will be performances, there will be music, comedy, a message tree, and it's all centred on positive approaches to mental health. The event will have a resource hub with two therapists and information on BEAT and eating disorders that can be shared. It will be live streamed also, so you don't have to come to Edinburgh to participate. I want to congratulate Shalhavit Simcha Cohen and all the organisers for putting this event together, and I'd encourage anyone struggling with mental health to go along. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I welcome this debate. I welcome the work which has been undertaken by the Scottish Government to improve the outcomes of people living with eating disorders in Scotland, and I look forward to hearing from my colleagues this evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Harper. Can I add my warm welcome to those in the public gallery as well, but perhaps encourage you not to participate much as you may be motivated to do so. I now call on Oliver Mundell, who will be followed by Jackie Dunbar for around 4 minutes, Mr Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I too, and those of us on these benches also, I welcome the fact we've got visitors back in the public gallery. And I think particularly in this debate, it serves as an important reminder of how important face-to-face and in-person are, and the role that discussing these things in public does to break down barriers, break down stigma, and bring what are often very personal and lonely challenges out into the open. And I'm very grateful to have the opportunity to speak in tonight's debate and play a small part in our collective effort here in this Parliament to break down those barriers and to raise awareness. It's a very complicated area, and the length of a number of conditions and disorders that Emma Harper set out, along with the range of symptoms, I think does show just how complicated it is, and it's easy, I think, sometimes to forget that. I'll come back to the substance of the debate in a moment, but I do want to take this chance to thank Emma Harper for securing the debate and the work that she does on this issue, including much behind the scenes to highlight eating disorders during the course of a number of cross-party groups here at Holyrood, including the cross-party group on mental health, which we both co-convene. And, you know, to me, certainly.
Emma Harper.
I would just, Presiding Officer, like to thank Oliver Mundell for mentioning the cross-party group on mental health, which we do co-convene. I forgot to mention that. Thank you.
Oliver Mundell.
Not at all. And for the fullness, I should say Beatrice Swisher also co-convenes that group with us. And I feel it is important to mention it because it's something the group has been looking at. And I also think that we often many people often fail to consider eating disorders when talking about mental health. They don't see it as part of the mental health remit. They don't think that eating disorders fall in the same level of seriousness. And we hear from the mortality rates and from the lived life experience of many just how wrong that is. And it's something that has to change if we're going to see the services that support those with eating disorders change and fully meet the need. I pay tribute to Emma Harper for her persistence on this issue because of its complexity. It is an area of policy and practice that does take persistence. When we see the bravery of people like Dennis Robertson and others who speak out on this, they deserve champions here in this Parliament. Over a million people of all ages and backgrounds across the UK have an eating disorder. It can affect anyone. There is no one who it can't affect. We've heard already about those high mortality rates, the highest amongst any mental illness. That in itself should demand action. And I've had a number of concerns.
Certainly.
Jackson Carlow.
Mr. Mundell wasn't, but I was a member when Dennis Robertson gave that speech, and partly the reason I'm here today is it was a profoundly moving occasion for all of us that were here. It was very courageous, very brave. I actually slightly struck by the fact that Ms. Harper indicated it was over 10 years, it was 10 years ago. And I just wonder, in terms of the advance that we have seen in the way in which mental health is appreciated and stigmas are appreciated, whether we feel that sufficient progress has actually been made in relation to the understanding of eating disorders, because I'm struck that we are here again today, and although much has been done, the fundamental issues about an appreciation of eating disorders and the consequences of them remain broadly similar to how they were when Dennis Robertson spoke.
Oliver Mundell, I'm happy to give you the time back.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think that's a very pertinent point, and that's one of the reasons I think why this year, as part of the awareness campaign, we've seen a very clear call for action around the Worth More Than 2 Hours campaign. It's something I've had constituents in touch about, but that's about making sure that frontline GPs receive more training and advice so that they can support those who ask for help. But it's also, I think, about making sure that a future generation of doctors are equipped to identify the signs and symptoms of eating disorders in order to facilitate the kind of early intervention Emma Harper was talking about and secure better outcomes and avoiding unnecessary pain and suffering, not just for individuals, but as has already come up in this debate, for their families too, because I think it's a huge burden for families to carry, particularly when they're struggling to access the level of support that they need. But there are examples of good practice, including at Glasgow University, and I'd be keen to hear from the Minister what's been done to make sure that these practices are replicated across all 5 Scottish medical schools, because this seems like a really straightforward and clear ask. We've got to remember that behind every one of these statistics we hear in this debate, there are real people, real families, members of our own parliamentary community in the past have experienced the pain of this. This can happen to anyone, and no one should be left to suffer alone. And I would close this debate in asking that we hear more from the Minister on what these working groups are doing to make real the promises we make here, by simply saying this to anyone listening to this debate at home: do seek advice, do seek help, and don't suffer in silence. There are lots of organisations, charities, individuals out there who stand ready to help you. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Mundell. I now call on Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Carol Mochan for around 4 minutes. Ms. Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And how can I follow the powerful speeches already done by Oliver Mundell and Emma Harper, but I will try. Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to participate in the members' debate today, brought forward by my colleague Emma Harper, highlighting Eating Disorder Awareness Week, and I thank her for bringing this important subject forward for debate this evening. Like Emma Harper, I'm also pleased to welcome the guests in the gallery today from BEAT, and as others in chamber have already said, can I also take this opportunity to recognise the work that former MSP Dennis Robertson did in initiating the debates, which has now been ongoing for over 10 years, and of course for raising awareness. Eating disorders are incredibly challenging mental illnesses that affect 1 in 50 people, included but not limited to binge eating disorder, bulimia, anorexia and other feeding or eating disorders. People with eating disorders are typically develop severe physical health problems and their quality of life can be severely impacted by these illnesses. It is therefore welcomed that the Scottish Government is committed to carrying out a national review of eating disorder services to improve the support for those people living with an eating disorder. Recovery is possible with access to the right treatment and support. We as politicians must do all we can to raise awareness of eating disorders, to ensure people do not suffer in silence, and so people are aware of the options that are available to them. I note that the National Review will provide a more complete picture of the current system of support for people with eating disorders and provide recommendations around how services and the wider support system should be constructed to ensure people have access to the right treatments and so support can be provided to all those affected by an eating disorder, whether that be individuals or their wider support network and families. This year's theme for Eating Disorder Awareness Week is medical training. An average medical student receives less than 2 hours training on eating disorders throughout their degree, with a fifth of medical schools offering no training on this subject. This lack of training for students must be addressed, and I am pleased to see that BEAT and other eating disorder charities are engaging with universities to ensure our medical professionals receive adequate training and have an understanding of the difficulties facing those with eating disorders. This training, however, should not just be rolled out to medical students. All healthcare professionals and social service professionals should have an awareness of eating disorders and know how to identify someone affected and know where to signpost them to should they wish to receive treatment. Presiding Officer, in addition to the work under... Yes, of course.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Jackie Dunbar, for taking an intervention. Just the training doesn't need to be so complicated. It doesn't aim to make people specialists. Would you agree that we want to raise awareness of what the most simplest approach could be to raise awareness and for like trigger signs that would lead to further referral pathways, for instance?
Jackie Dunbar, I give you the time back.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Absolutely. I think everybody should be made aware of the trigger signs and hopefully be able to have the information at hand to be able to pass on where to get support. Presiding Officer, in addition to the work undertaken by BEAT to raise awareness for eating disorders, I've been made aware of an excellent support group in my area, the North East Eating Disorder Support Group, who are a self-help group welcoming all adults affected by an eating disorder, whether that be as a sufferer, partner, relative or friend. I believe that they continue to meet on the first Monday of every month at 7:30 p.m. and I'm just going to give them that wee plug. And this group allows people suffering with an eating disorder to interact with other people in a similar situation, to meet monthly, as I said, to share experiences in a safe and confidential setting and offering support to each other whilst looking towards recovering. It is absolutely essential that anyone suffering or believes they may be suffering from an eating disorder seeks help and support as soon as possible, and I would like to make that absolutely clear. Presiding Officer, there is support available and I would encourage folk out there to reach out, take that help and begin the journey to recovery. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Dunbar. I now call on Carol Mochan to be followed by Siobhan Brown again for around 4 minutes. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Emma Harper, as always, for bringing this really important debate to the Chamber. And like others, I take this opportunity to give Scottish Labour support to the aims and objectives of Eating Disorder Awareness Week 2022. And welcome, of course, to the BEAT audience that is so nice to see you here. As we have heard already, eating disorders are not uncommon, and with 1 in 50 people in Scotland and the wider UK being affected, and tragically we know that their impact can be fatal, with more people losing their lives due to eating disorders than in any other mental health condition. Deputy Presiding Officer, this is absolutely shocking, yet it does act as a reminder to us that eating disorders are both prominent and serious, and as such we must raise much greater awareness of eating disorders, their treatments, their causes and their symptoms. Indeed, I consider it as important to look at raising awareness from different angles. It is absolutely crucial that individuals are aware of the signs of having an eating disorder so that they can make informed judgments and reach out for support themselves. But it is also important, although very difficult, to be able to recognise an eating disorder in someone else so that support can be offered and a conversation can be had. Because of the individual suffering, talking may be a challenge, a step too far perhaps. However, Deputy Presiding Officer, as highlighted in the motion today, the issue we face regarding eating disorders are wide and ranging. As it has been reported, as we've heard from BEAT, an organisation focused on raising awareness of eating disorders and providing support, that the average GP student will receive less than 2 hours of training on eating disorders during their entire medical degree. Less than 2 hours. Deputy Presiding Officer, a condition that impacts over 1 million people across the UK, it does take a minute to really take that in. And even more concerningly, we are told that a fifth of UK medical students do not provide any training on eating disorders, as we've heard from some other members. And I think we are saying this is simply unacceptable. I spent many years working in the health service as a dietitian, part of the Allied Health Professions team, and I know only too well the importance of raising awareness of conditions and disorders and of training future health professionals. When I come to the Chamber, if I can, I like to mention the Allied Health Professions, and in this debate it is important. They do have an important contribution to make. But what is important that as a professional in that group, we often discuss the importance of training and how we should make sure people are aware of all the various conditions across the spectrum. And as such, I give my full support to the BEAT, who are calling for more training on eating disorders to be provided during medical training at UK universities. However, we also know the struggles Scotland's mental health services face. We know the non-discriminatory nature of eating disorders, and as such, we know that from CAMHS to mental health support in later life, the Scottish Government do need to act more. Indeed, looking towards the future, although welcome that the 15 recommendations for improving eating disorders awareness and services have been accepted by the Scottish Government, it must address the Royal College of Psychiatrists' calls to go that bit further. These include a call on the Scottish Government to outline how it will evaluate progress towards the delivery of these recommendations, and a call to ensure research into eating disorders in Scotland addresses our gaps in understanding the impact of these conditions on minority communities. These are considered requests, and I hope the Minister will give due consideration to them. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, it is clear that the speech is so far that the contribution and research made by charities, experts and others are there, and their work is so well done. With cross-party cooperation, the work can be done and we can start to address the real concerns held by individuals, charities and others across the country. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mochan. I now call on Siobhan Brown to be followed by Gillian Mackay. Around 4 minutes, Ms Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to thank my colleague Emma Harper for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. Eating disorders remain one of the most taboo topics to discuss. On Eating Disorders Week, I hope this debate will shine a light on this illness. The focus of this Awareness Week is ensuring all medical schools provide adequate training on eating disorders and that doctors are equipped with the knowledge to identify signs and symptoms and be trained to intervene so we can end the pain, suffering and often deadly consequences caused by eating disorders. As we've heard, eating disorders include anorexia nervosa, bulimia nervosa, restricting food, binge eating and overeating, just to name a few. They are a serious form of mental illness with serious medical consequences and the highest mortality rate of all mental disorders. In recent days, I've heard the story of Grace, who started dieting at 16 because she was overweight as a result of eating convenience food. She, like many teenagers, wanted to lose weight and started to eat healthily at first, but then began to cut corners to be able to eat what she actually wanted. Her mum spotted the pattern that Grace was falling into and she took her to the doctor. The GP put it down to a thing that girls do and she was sent to a dietitian. This tale is a familiar story for people when they visit the GP. But what else can we expect when less than 2 hours is often dedicated in medical schools to eating disorders and one in five medical schools have no training in the illness at all? I need to acknowledge all the great work that's been done by Beat Eating Disorder and the Scottish Government investment. In a survey conducted by UK Eating Disorder Charity Beat in late 2021, 60% of patients with an eating disorder felt they received poor care from their GP, and 58% felt that their GP didn't understand eating disorders. 51 out of the 93 supporters with lived experience in Scotland felt the care they received from the GP was poor to very poor. This must change. The lack of training is having devastating consequences. If we go back to Grace, as she waited to be seen by a dietitian, she found herself sitting in a room with four other girls that she knew, a sign of how common these disorders can be. And Grace recalls sitting there with a dietitian, and she felt like it was just a tick box exercise with questions. What is wrong? Why aren't you eating? How do you feel when you eat? She was put on a diet plan and asked to write a food diary, but she lied, and no one ever checked up on her. She talked to the other girls, and they all did the same thing. They lied on their form, and not one medical professional ever checked or questioned this. Eventually, she just stopped going, and she fell off the radar. Grace grew from a teenager into an adult, and she took the eating disorder with her. At 23, she made a breakthrough with a doctor in AIR, a young female doctor who understood her, listened to her, and really wanted to help her. But unfortunately, the doctor wasn't long at the practice, and Grace was back to square one. What would have happened if that first doctor was like that? The Scottish Eating Disorder Services Review in 2021 recommended that there should be appropriate training for all professionals, and that there should be particular focus on early intervention, medical aspects of care and support, and training should range from undergraduate healthcare training to specialist training. However, there is good news. To date, Glasgow University Medical School has been an early trailblazer in delivering the new training package. We must lead the way by ensuring all five medical schools and the foundation programme in Scotland. Yes?
Oliver Mundell.
Siobhan Brown, for giving way, I just wonder if you'd recognise that the Scottish Government has a really important role to play in encouraging that best practice to be shared across all five medical schools.
Siobhan Brown.
I thank Oliver Mundell for that, yes, and I do agree, and I think they've dedicated the funding, and we see it in Glasgow University. So, yes, I think they're totally aware that it needs to be rolled out to all the five medical schools. If we fast forward from Grace at 23, she's now 29, and she talks about the struggle she faced quite openly. And although for the mental effects have subsided, the physical effects have not. She knows she has caused herself damage, but the answer from the doctor is more pills and an IBS diagnosis. But no one will listen, and we need to stop, and we need to listen to those with lived experiences. Recovery is possible. Look at Grace. The plea from people like Grace is this just isn't a thing teenagers do. It's a serious mental illness with grave consequences, and such deserves money and resources ploughed into it to help fund research. The Scottish Government need to ensure full implementation of the Scottish Eating Disorder Services Review recommendations including the allocation of sufficient funding, workforce and staff training. And we now know that the pandemic has compounded this issue, making it worse for those battling the illness and affecting others for the first time. Let me finish by repeating what my colleagues have already said. Help is out there. Take down this number. It's for BEAT. Their trained advisers can offer one-to-one help. 0808 801 0432. If talking is too hard, email scotlandhelp@beateatingdisorders.org.uk. But please seek help. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Brown. And I call on Gillian Mackay, who will be followed by the final speaker in the open debate, Gillian Martin. Again, 4 minutes, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I too would like to start by welcoming those in the gallery and thanking Emma Harper for bringing forward this important debate. My thoughts are with everyone affected by an eating disorder. Lockdown was a lonely, distressing time for many people, and I cannot imagine how difficult it's been for people with eating disorders who may have had to cope without access to their usual support systems. Research by the eating disorder charity BEAT has suggested that 61% of adults who received care for their eating disorder had less contact with services as a result of the pandemic. As we recover from the pandemic, it's vital that we ensure this support is restored. We must also tackle stigma. There are many misconceptions about eating disorders, one being that someone must be extremely thin or underweight to suffer from disordered eating. We are learning more all the time about the different ways in which eating disorders manifest, and awareness of less common eating disorders, such as avoidant or restrictive food intake disorder and orthorexia, is increasing. Yes, of course.
Stephen Kerr.
And thank you, Gillian Mackay, for giving way. One of the concerns I have, and I wonder whether she shares this concern, is the distorting effect of social media, particularly on young men and young women, who see images that are frankly unreal. They're filtered or photoshopped. Would it be, I mean, does the member agree that influencers, celebrities have a special responsibility to be truthful in the way they portray image in social media, on social media platforms? Would you also agree that it would be a good idea if social media companies labelled filtered or unfiltered, photoshopped or unphotoshopped images so that people can know what's real and what's not real?
Gillian Mackay, and happy again to give you your time back.
Thank you. I thank Stephen Kerr for the intervention. As someone who grew up in the early to mid-2000s, when diet culture was probably at some of its peak, and those pictures of very, very thin celebrities were rife, I think it is incumbent on everybody to take stock of what they are portraying actually influences those around them. I think it is important for social media organisations to have a look at how their content is affecting everybody around them, and I think it is something that we probably need more research and more of a look into to actually assess some of the impacts that they're having, particularly on teenagers and young adults. It's also important to note that symptoms may not fall into neat categories such as anorexic and bulimic, but may overlap and be classified as other specified or eating disorder. A friend was kind enough to share their story with me. She did not menstruate for years because she was restricting to the extent that she was underweight, but was told by her GP that she was fine because her BMI was borderline. There is an argument to be made for greater inclusion of eating disorders in medical training. This Eating Disorder Awareness Week, BEAT have highlighted that on average, UK medical students receive less than 2 hours of teaching on eating disorders throughout their entire medical degree, and a fifth of medical schools do not include eating disorders at all in their teaching. BEAT have argued that eating disorders are highly complex mental illnesses which cannot be adequately covered in 2 hours, and I have a lot of sympathy with that view. I, like many others, have received numerous emails from constituents this week asking me to write to the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care to bring this issue to their attention and find out what is being done at a national level to ensure that all future doctors are equipped to identify the early signs and symptoms of an eating disorder. And I'd be grateful if the Minister could address this in his closing speech. I'm sure everyone in this chamber would agree that eating disorders should form part of medical education. In their briefing for today, the Royal College of Psychiatrists highlighted that anorexia nervosa is prevalent among 1% of women and 0.5% of men and has the highest mortality rate for any type of severe mental illness. Women are likelier to present with an eating disorder, as are LGBT people. I've raised the need for improved data on mental health before in this chamber and will continue to do so. The Royal College of Psychiatrists have said that there are real gaps in our knowledge as to the impact of eating disorders, in particular on our ethnically diverse and LGBT communities. I'd be grateful to hear from the Minister on what action is taken to improve this and whether we have data on how people from minority ethnic backgrounds are impacted by eating disorders, given that there is often inadequate data on the mental health of minority ethnic communities. As well as training for future medical staff, we need to ensure time is made for current staff to improve their awareness and learn from new research. The Eating Disorder Services Review found that services have seen increased numbers of referrals since the start of the pandemic, and that they are seeing people present later and significantly more physically unwell. It also said that CAMHS eating disorder leads have reported an unprecedented increase in the number and severity of children and young people presenting with eating disorders. These findings were extremely worrying, and it's vital that we receive regular reports on what action is being taken to improve eating disorder services and help them to meet growing demand. The Royal College of Psychiatrists have highlighted that nearly a year on since the publication of the Eating Disorder Services Review, we need to know what progress is being made towards delivering the recommendations set out in the review. They've called on the Scottish Government to outline how it will evaluate progress towards delivering on these recommendations, and I would ask the Minister to address this in his closing speech as well. I appreciate there's a lot in that. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mackay. And I now call on Gillian Martin for around 4 minutes, Ms Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I thank Emma Harper for securing this debate. She's led this debate for quite a few years now. She consistently brings the subject of eating disorders up in this chamber. And she also makes sure, and I know this firsthand, she makes sure it's factored in where appropriate and possible in our committee work as well. And of course, Oliver Mundell mentioned the work that the mental health CPG does as well. Emma's also highlighted about the issue of increased instances and problems with people who are suffering from eating disorders during the pandemic as well. And we recently did some work on in the health committee on the mental health of young people, and Emma was sure to make sure that that was factored in, and I absolutely commend her for that. As I do, she follows in the footsteps in our friend and colleague Dennis Robertson, who many have mentioned, and rightly so, and we can't underestimate the impact that Dennis's work has had and continues to have in raising the awareness, all of which of course he does in the name of his daughter Caroline, who tragically lost her life. We talk about many difficult and complex issues in this chamber, and I see it's our job. This is a very difficult and complex issue, and as well, suicide is an issue that we find difficult to talk about as well. And out there in the public, I don't think there's the awareness of the impact that eating disorders can have on suicidal ideation, particularly in young women. And when we do talk about mortality rates and eating disorders, I think many first think of the tragic deaths being solely as a result of complications down to deteriorating physical health. Of course, that's a factor, but the mental health conditions of binge eating, anorexia, and nervosa and bulimia. I was taken aback to find out just how many sufferers attempt or complete suicide. And that rate of mortality with those with eating disorders, really hard to sometimes contemplate that, particularly for families who are terrified of one of their own who's struggling with an eating disorder. I really can only imagine how difficult it is to hear that one in six with an eating disorder will try to end their own life. Makes an already frightening concept for parents and families even more frightening. But people can and do get better, and I would point to the massively improved CAMHS service in Aberdeen has been a model on how to access mental health services that can much better and more appropriate for at-risk young people in that modern and appropriate setting that we now have in Aberdeen City. I'm also grateful to BEAT for their briefing today and grateful for the work that they do on the importance of early intervention and support for families. As I say, frightened families who can fear the worst may happen and also fear that there's little that they can do I've had those conversations with Dennis Robertson about the fear that him and his wife Anne had when Caroline was suffering, that they might do the wrong thing and the support that wasn't out there for them. Families need expert advice, and BEAT absolutely provides pathways to that. Parents and guardians worry that the door might not be enough, that they manage to get their young person through, that the medical professional they see might not have the expertise, and Siobhan Brown mentioned their situation where that was the case, or that the waiting list, they fear that the waiting list might be too long and they don't know what they can do in the meantime. So as always, when I speak on this issue, I will ensure I put a link to BEAT's excellent website and I'll put their phone number up there on my social media. I won't echo much of what's been said by others about the training of medical professionals, except to say that it is a very important theme. But it's not just medical professionals that can benefit from training and awareness. And I do want to talk about what training might be helpful for the earliest of interventions, parents, young people and teachers, and the potentially negative influence of social media. When I was a teenager, that debate was around images in women's magazines, but they only came out monthly, bi-monthly, if at all. And now there's this constant stream of images of so-called perfection on tap, TikTok, Instagram, websites with tips on how to starve yourself, hitting the top of Google searches, these pro-Anna or Thinspiration websites. There's been some progress in them being called out, but they're still out there. And I don't think that the social media companies are doing enough to bring them down. But I also want to point to something else, and that's body shaming clickbait in tabloids and online as well, which exacerbate the mental health issues that young women might face. Presiding officer, with so many aspects on the impact, if she's, I've got time...
She's just winding up, so I'm it needs to be a very brief intervention, Stephen.
I wanted to mention young women, and I think it's important to put on the record that young men are also impacted by these images.
Gillian Martin.
Yeah, forgive me, and of course, young men, of course, are impacted as well. And obviously, sometimes as a woman, I don't forget that, but I do think about women a lot because, of course, it's my lived experience as well. Presiding officer, there are so many aspects of the impact on mental health of women in particular and men, Stephen Kerr's mentioned. I urge social media companies and media companies in general to do far more than they are at the moment. They're making staggering profits from our reliance on them, from their psychotechnical tactics, having us glued to their content. It's time for them to be far more responsible for the content they share that can harm young people. Presiding officer.
Thank you, Ms Martin. I now call on the Minister to wind up the debate for around 7 minutes. Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding officer. 7 minutes doesn't seem long enough to answer all of those questions. Can I, first of all, welcome folks to the gallery, to Emma Broadhurst, BEAT's National Officer for Scotland, and the BEAT ambassadors. It's great to see you here today. And I welcome this debate to mark Eating Disorder Awareness Week 2022. This debate allows us to raise awareness about eating disorders and the terrible impact that they can have on those who are diagnosed and their family and friends too. And I want to thank Emma Harper for lodging the motion this year and for focusing our minds on how significant this subject is. And I'm really pleased that our minds are focused on this at least once a year. But I see it as part of my job to make that focus, not just the once a year debate that Dennis Robertson instituted, but to get folk to start speaking about this more and more. And Jackson Carlow rightly asked, what has changed? Well, I think a lot has changed. For a start off, the communication about eating disorders is much less taboo than it was when Dennis Robertson first stood up in this chamber 10 years ago. And that means that more folk are actually seeking the help that they need. As a government, we are making significant investments in our mental health services because we know that the pandemic has had a huge impact on people's mental health. We are aiming to encourage recovery and renewal as we emerge from the pandemic. And this includes dedicated actions to improve support for those with an eating disorder and their families and carers, which I'll touch upon later in my response, Presiding Officer. I also want to extend my thanks and my appreciation to all those across the country that work day in and day out to support the recovery of those with an eating disorder and their families. And as has already been mentioned this evening, the theme of this year's Awareness Week is to encourage our medical schools in Scotland to ensure that they are providing eating disorder training to medical students. And this will ensure that our future workforce is equipped with the skills and the confidence to provide the support that people across our country require. And I'm very pleased that our medical schools here in Scotland are all in discussions with BEAT to deliver eating disorder training or are already delivering it. And I want to mention the University of Glasgow in particular, who were the first in the UK to adopt BEAT's training. And I think that the folks from BEAT themselves have called them the trailblazers, and I think that is the case. But we need all of our other medical schools here in Scotland to follow suit, and I am quite sure that we can do so. And I'll take Mr. Mundell, Presiding Officer.
Oliver Mundell.
I'm really grateful to the Minister for taking an intervention. I just wonder whether he hopes, obviously, universities are independent institutions, but whether or not he hopes that by this time next year, all universities will have moved forward and be offering this vital training.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, they are independent institutions, as Mr. Mundell has rightly said, but they have all engaged with BEAT, and I think that is a very good sign. And we will do all that we can to persuade all of them to move that forward. It's also vital that our GPs and those that work in our primary care services feel confident in spotting the early signs of an eating disorder and understand the complexities of this type of illness. They are a key player in ensuring that when someone comes forward for support, they are directed to the right treatment. We don't want to see any more situations like Grace had to deal with in AIR. And as I've mentioned, during the last 2 years, we have taken significant actions to ensure that those who require support for an eating disorder can receive timely access to appropriate treatment. And our transition and recovery plan, which was published in October of 2020, is backed by that £120 million recovery and renewal fund, which will help transform services with a renewed focus on prevention and early intervention. In June of last year, I was pleased to announce £5 million to implement the recommendations of the National Eating Disorders Review. The majority of this funding has been provided to NHS boards to support them to respond to the increase in eating disorder referrals. And early feedback highlights that boards have used the funding to ensure their staff have access to the right training, expand clinician time, and to recruit additional staff. But here I would also bring in Julian Martin's point around about the changes that were made to services, CAM services in Grampian, which made a real difference in modernising services and getting things right. And we need to export that best practice right across Scotland, which is not quite the case yet, but that's why we've put our CAM specifications in place to ensure that that happens. A very brief intervention from Mr. Kerr.
Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Minister. Minister, do you also agree with Gillian Martin's comments about the need for social media companies to take more responsibility for the content that's published on their platforms?
Happy to give you, Minister, the latitude I've given every other speaker to a generous 7 minutes.
I will come to that towards the end of my speech, but I will definitely address the issue. I want to move on because we have seen that additional recruitment of staff in our NHS, but we have also provided over £400,000 to BEAT, the UK's eating disorder charity, to provide a wide range of support options to families and carers, as well as support for children, young people and adults impacted by an eating disorder. Feedback from these services highlights just how important different types of support can be, with one user reporting that, for the first time, I was with a group of people who totally understood what I was going through. It is so reassuring to hear others' experiences with eating disorders and to know that you are not alone. It was because of this feedback that I have commissioned additional services from BEAT to be nationally rolled out across Scotland beginning in April. We have awarded BEAT over £300,000 to provide expanded helpline support until midnight, 7 days a week, improved carer support through NHS board referrals, specific binge eating disorder support services, and beyond the symptoms training for those that are currently GPs and other healthcare professionals to support them to identify when a patient has an eating disorder and confidently intervene early. And I believe from a conversation that we had earlier on today with BEAT that we will be the first part of the UK to have BEAT deliver all of their suite of services in our country. So I'm glad that Scotland is leading the way in all of this. I'm also pleased to provide an update on the Eating Disorders Implementation Group, which was established last year to take forward from the recommendations from the National Review. And I'll be attending the group's next meeting. And I think there are specific questions from the debate which I must answer, Presiding Officer, in regards to that. Because Emma Harper herself asked about when we would publish the lived experience panel specification. That will be published very shortly. She also asked about the data working group, and it's planning to meet in the next 2 weeks. And on the subject of data, which Gillian Mackay and others have brought up, we don't yet have the right data in all of this. And that's one of the reasons why we have established this group. We need to do better on that front, and with their help, we will no doubt do so. I think the other aspects of this is that we need to get over what Siobhan Brown described as being a taboo subject. I think that the more that we speak about it, the more we encourage others to speak about eating disorders and some of the other very difficult subjects that come with mental ill health, self-harm, suicide, as Gillian Martin mentioned, the more impact we can make in actually getting it right for people. Presiding Officer, Mr Kerr has talked around about the online aspect of this. We don't have powers in this Parliament to deal with some of the social media and internet providers. But I would hope that every single member in this chamber will engage with the bill that is proposed and currently going through the House of Commons on this issue. Not just in terms of eating disorders and these so-called influencers and the things that they do, but also from every other aspect of mental health. Because I don't think that that bill goes far enough. And it doesn't really matter what I think in some regards. The third sector organisations here, those folk at the front line, don't think that that goes far enough, including the likes of the Samaritan. So I think, you know, we could maybe get some cross-border agreement, cross-chamber agreement even, to get cross-border agreement to really beef that bill up somewhat to get rid of some of the nonsenses that exist on social media channels. Presiding Officer, I'll close again by thanking Emma Harper for lodging the motion for this debate this evening. I also want to once again reiterate my support and thanks to the staff who have been working tirelessly throughout the pandemic to support those with an eating disorder and their families. I can assure them and I can assure BEAT that you have this government's full support. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.